The Grieving Therapist. Caring for yourself and your clients when it feels like the end of the world. By Larisa A. Garski, LMFT, and Justine Mastin, LMFT. Narrated by Justine Mastin. Published by North Atlantic Books. Dedication. For death, who reminds us to live. In gratitude to our communities who support us. And in memoriam to Marinim, who died while we wrote this book. Foreword. I never want to help another person ever again for as long as I live, I cried out in the early summer of 2022. As a clinical counselor and operator of a large training company in eye movement desensitization and reprocessing, EMDR therapy, who manages scores of team members, plus our therapist students, from day one of the COVID-19 lockdown, I stayed optimistic and operated in fierce worker bee mode. I proudly lived by the motto, if you don't adapt and swim, you will sink and die. So even as I continued to take care of myself the best way I knew how, I wasn't fully relating to the struggles of my colleagues, or indeed of many of the people I served. I largely dissociated from my own feelings about the world crumbling in around me by working and taking care of others, one of my default settings as a human. Then a series of personal life transitions, which included an unexpected move and learning to live with a new partner, coupled with the demands of running a business in our current climate, caused me to hit a wall. I thought, why the hell am I doing this to myself? I'm just going to burn it all to the ground and go and set up a fruit stand on a beach highway, maybe in Hawaii, maybe in Croatia, just somewhere far away from here. And then I got an email from Justine Mastin asking me if I would write the foreword for this book. I chuckled, ever amused by the universe's sense of humor. Clearly, this is a book that I personally needed to read during this season of my life, and I am so glad I did. And I am even more excited that other therapists will benefit from its wisdom at this time in history, when truth-telling is a lost art, yet is so desperately needed. A mutual friend and colleague introduced me to Justine in 2016. After I saw what she created with Yoga Quest and other creative ventures, I became a top member of her fandom, pop culture community. I then met Larisa in 2021, when the two of them collaborated on writing their book, Starship Therapies. And my expressive artist soul beamed with excitement when I realized what these two were putting out into the world. And I was so glad to learn that there are other therapists who are out and proud about their creativity. For it is creativity that is needed to work with the most complex cases that we see in our practices. And it is creativity and expression that will fuel the revolution that our field needs to heal itself. Justine and Larisa write with a great deal of whimsy, while also not shying away from the hard subjects of what makes being a therapist in the modern era so hard. They take on the perils of dealing with insurance, the rigid structures around training and formation, and how, as natural caretakers, we are vulnerable to being overworked in the name of doing the right thing. I shook my head in agreement so many times as I read The Grieving Therapist, even shouting out, "Preach, preach," a few times. Yet the motifs and metaphors they used also caused me to ponder how I most want to spend my time as a person and as a creative being on this planet. And as if the universe couldn't get enough of her own sense of humor, I contracted COVID-19 in August 2022 as I was reading through The Grieving Therapist. Having managed to avoid the illness for over 2 years, I ended up having an experience similar to what Justine writes about in this book. As I navigated my own several weeks of hell with COVID, I was grateful to know I was not alone in what I was feeling. Today, I'm grateful to both Justine and Larisa for their vulnerability in this work. I've long taught that therapists and people in positions of power need to be more open about their human struggles. Because so many of us think we are bad therapists, and thus bad people, for having very human experiences. Embracing our humanity is the key to embracing our wholeness. And when we can accept this challenge, everyone around us can ultimately benefit. Grief is messy and complicated, and it can tie you up in knots. Particularly when one has to navigate many different layers of grief. Even Elizabeth Kubler-Ross acknowledged that the five stages, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance, are a part of the framework that makes up our learning to live with the one we lost. They are tools to help us frame and identify what we may be feeling, but they are not stops on some linear timeline in grief. Justine and Larisa do not shy away from the mess. They dive right in to name it and to explore it. And that's why this book is what our field needs right now. Thank you both for telling the truth. Through this lost art of storytelling, we stand a chance of unraveling the knots and healing our shame.
Jamie Marich, PhD, LPCCS, REAT, RYT 500.
Introduction. They say there's good grief. But how can you tell it from the bad? Maybe it's only in the fact, good grief's the one that's in your past. Dessa. We tried to write this introduction so many times. But how do you introduce grief? In a top hat and tap shoes? Justine's choice. Perhaps you go retro and quote Emily Dickinson. After great pain, a formal feeling comes. Larisa's choice. You could zoom out to the macro and lean into the longevity of our global grief, rising sea levels, hundreds of thousands dead from a pandemic, ineffectual government. Or you could zoom in incredibly close and go micro with a personal anecdote. After so many rewrites, we must admit, we found ourselves feeling aggrieved. Ain't that just the way? Grief is many things. It brings terror and tears and gifts in shitty wrapping paper. It has zero fucks to give about timing. So even though the timing of this introduction finds us personally and professionally bereaved, we're going to do our best to find some humor in the pain and some joy in the pathos. To paraphrase one of our personal favorites, Carl Jung, you know you're really alive when you're feeling all of it. The good, the bad, and the ugly. Therapy, like life, should contain all of it. And since this is a book by therapists, for therapists, then this book also needs to contain all of it. Or to paraphrase a client, it needs to be properly lifey. The truth is that there is no right way to start, because this isn't the beginning of a story. It's the middle. We are all still living inside the trauma, not reflecting upon it from some future place. So, reader, we join you in the middle of our grief, which we will lay out for you like a map. This feels appropriate, as maps themselves have no beginning and end. They simply are. And there are a multitude of routes to take across them. There are indeed many roads to the summit. But before we dive into the life of this book, we need to check our map-making supplies and review our provisions. To put this in purely scholastic terms, we're going to offer a note on theoretical orientation, a summary of structure, and a perspective on self-disclosure. And we'll conclude with a word on methodology. This journey into grief will take us into uncharted territory for which there are yet no complete maps. But together, reader, we hope to draft a guidebook. A note on theoretical orientation. This is not an academic text, though it is a book informed by the work of many academics and researchers in the fields of marriage and family therapy, psychology, counseling, education, post-traumatic growth, and philosophy. And we do hope you find it useful in the classroom. In creating this book, our goal was to both invite and evoke grieving emotions for you, the reader, and to co-create a supportive community within which you can sit and practice being present with such intense feelings as pain, joy, despair, hope, sadness, fear, and anger. While this book is informed by the work of many, Vanessa Machado de Oliveira Andriotti, Audre Lorde, Soren Kierkegaard, Michael Ende, and Janina Scarlett, to name just a few, the researchers and work we chose to directly incorporate into each chapter are grounded in their ability to evoke feelings, including, perhaps most especially, those uncomfortable feelings and experiences you may have been avoiding for months, if not years. We've pulled thinkers from across fields of study, ranging from activism to Zen. Our intention is for this book to be an experiential journey into your own grieving. Therefore, don't be surprised if this book doesn't mention your favorite research or journal articles. We've chosen our sages for the impact they've had on the world around them, the general zeitgeist, and/or on us, the authors. These thinkers are, as are we all, imperfect humans, who we believe have important messages to share with you in your time of grieving, even when that important message is anger. We have included each thinker's cultural and/or ethnic heritage in an effort to normalize the variety of humans who have contributed to our collective experiences, both conscious and unconscious. We share all of this in advance not to frighten you away from this book, but rather to help you make an informed choice. Although this book is meant to challenge, it's also meant to delight. Play, which entails imagination, jokes, puns, and riddles, helps us build cognitive flexibility. It allows us to express our feelings without getting too attached to any particular outcome or result. It can also do the simple but mighty task of eliciting a smile, which is something all too rare in our field in these times. To help create a sense of play, we use the framing device of you, the reader, embarking on your own hero's journey to explore and map the 10 realms of grief: plague, chronic illness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.